All right. It's my pleasure now to be joined by a future NFL Hall of Famer, I'm sure, none other than D’Ante Smith. D’Ante, how's it going today?
It's going good. What about you?
I'm hanging in there, man. You know, we're at the end of February. Snow's starting to melt, so life's good out here in New England. But, you know, I'm sure you're doing good because it's this crazy time as you work your way up to getting into the NFL draft. But there's no NFL combine. So just to kick this off, man, A, how are you doing? But B, you know, how are you just sort of working on your craft knowing that this huge thing that most guys in your shoes would always be looking to isn't happening this year?
Like I said, I'm doing well. And, you know, what I've really been trying to focus on is just my pro day. My pro day for East Carolina is March 30th. So that's been like my focus. That's going to be my combine this year. And, you know, I plan on putting up some good numbers, you know what I mean? So I've just been trying to prepare my body and my mind so I can consistently do what I want to do.
Well, you know, the combine is just like one of those things that everyone watches, and it's a big event. Do you feel like you're missing anything by not being able to go? Or for you, is it just not a big deal? What you're going to handle business however you have to?
I'm definitely missing something, you know what I mean? Not being able to – we all are. From not being able to participate in the combine physically this year as far as like showing our athleticism. But, you know, I just got to roll with what's going this year. I got to make the best out of that pro day opportunity. So that's going to be the next best opportunity.
So when it comes to like an offensive lineman doing a pro day, there's obviously the stuff that they measure at the combine, you know, the vertical 40, all that stuff. Do you plan on doing anything outside of just those measurables or any sort of one-on-one type of stuff?
You know, if the situation presents itself, I don't mind, but currently right now I don't have any plan.
Well, you know, if you don't do it, and I think it's pretty normal to not do that. I think what you did at the Senior Bowl is going to stand out because, you know, even though you didn't get a chance to play in the game, man, from what you did that week, which is basically all the scouts care about, is you tore it up. Not very easy for an offensive lineman to stand out at the Senior Bowl, but you know, when everyone wants to look at the edge rushers and all this, I mean, you were the guy that got in their way. So just heading into that, you know, what were your expectations just heading into that week?
You know, I just, I'm a firm believer in God. So I just kept continuing to pray for him to guide my steps and just continue to guide my training so I can play how I envision myself and just give myself the best opportunity to be me. I just was praying to give God the best opportunity, give me the chance to be the best opportunity to be me and give me the ability to capitalize when it's time. And, you know, he if you work hard for it, he'll help you out. So that's part of my what happened.
Now, did you put like any extra pressure on this? Because I'm sure that senior year did not go the way you wanted with the injury and everything. So, you know, were you really hyping this up as I need to get out there and show everyone what I can do?
It wasn't like that in my head. For me, it was like, well, I was really disappointed about not being able to play my senior year just because of some of like the little injuries that I had and stuff like that. So I really wanted to play. So just me being back out there, it was like, okay, I'm out here now. It just was like, it just felt good to be back out here. It just felt good to compete and like show people, you know what I mean, what I had been working on, what I wanted to show in this 2020 season. I just didn't have a chance to.
And from what I could tell, you know, what ECU put up is that your weight was about 275, yet you showed up weighing about 300. So how much emphasis did you put on getting that extra weight to really play at the NFL level?
Yes, sir. I've just been focusing on making sure my nutrition is correct. You know what I mean? I'm eating the appropriate amount of calories for my body so that I, you know what I mean? I function correctly. Also, I maintain my weight correctly and, you know what I mean? It's not fat weight that's getting on me. It's more muscle mass. So, you know, it's all a part of my nutrition right now.
Yeah, yeah. No, and you looked the part during the Senior Bowl week, man. You know, you play – it's not that easy to see offensive linemen play with a sort of style or a swagger, but, man, I just – anyone that watched the clip saw this kind of mean, nasty style where you were just sort of tossing guys at times. So, you know, can we talk about your style for a minute? You know, has that – how do you just approach playing it? Because it feels different than just the average guy.
you know, I just kind of like, I've always played football. I've always, like, when I'm doing anything competitive, I'm going 100%. So I just feel like that's just me competing. And I just feel like a little bit of how, like, my, like how I am on the football field and more developed, like more in high school, just with like one of my friends, Mikael and Crawley. That's just how we used to play. Just like, who can get the most pancakes? Who can do this? Who can do that? So it's just kind of like been embedded in me.
No, for you to be able to do that and play that way, but also have the versatility to do it at multiple positions. I mean, how did you work on your technique to be able to basically play anywhere on the line?
You know, coming into East Carolina, I didn't know exactly what position I was going to be playing. So, you know, I worked different positions there. And also at East Carolina, you know, I started at one game at left guard. So I kind of understood guard a little bit, you know, with some extra training and stuff like that with my offensive line trainer, just on different guard sets and stuff like that. Talking to my offensive line coach for the Panthers at the time at the Senior Bowl, Coach Myers, getting some tips from him on, like, inside. You know, that really helped me a lot during that week. Just getting some tips and stuff to help me continue through. So it was really about, like, taking what I already knew and just making sure, you know what I mean, just do the fundamentals and see if you could pick up on some stuff as you go.
Yeah, for sure. So, you know, we have Coach Myers, but then from what I could see, it's three different positional coaches over 5 years in college. So, you know, what's it like kind of having a different guy every year tell you something a little bit different? I mean, do you think that helped you because you see all these different styles, or did it kind of hurt your ability to grow because you kept getting told these different things?
I believe it helped me, especially in the long run. I feel like even though, you know what I mean, different coaches have different ways of doing things, different ways they want to coach their fundamentals and stuff like that, you know what I mean, it developed me into being able to do different things. You know what I mean, being able to understand the differences between a certain set or why a certain coach wants it like this, and being able to actually do it and switch it up, you know what I mean? So that's something I like really took time to appreciate. And also, you know what I mean, three different coaches. And all of my coaches are all three different types of people, like my former offensive line coaches. So they're all three different types of people. So it's just also like a way of like learning different, you know what I mean? Seeing exactly the little tips that they have, because, you know, each offensive line coach has their little guru tips and things that they may like to improvise. So that really helped me out a lot.
Yeah, no, definitely makes sense. You got coaches telling you what to do, but, you know, were there specific, you know, teammates or even like guys that you watched film on, like how did you, or who would you accredit to helping you also up your game?
Garrett McGinn. I used to watch, a lot of football anyways. Like, I watch a lot of my own. I study a lot of NFL offensive linemen on my own, but, Garrett McGinn, he's an offensive lineman from East Carolina also too. He's in the NFL. He just kind of like, you know what I mean, just kind of like showed me how to take emphasis in being a better player.
Very cool. So who are you actually watching film on then in the NFL?
I watch film on a lot of people. The person I probably mainly watch film on is Laremy Tunsil. But I watch film on a lot of people. I watch Deion Dawkins and like Teron and different people, you know what I mean, sort of like different athletic abilities. Sometimes similar to mine, sometimes a little different, so I could pick up on things.
Yeah, definitely. Maybe, like I said, when I kind of saw a little bit of that nastiness streak in your play, I was like, oh, there's some shades of Quentin Nelson in there with just sort of like having your own stamp on your game. You know, if you're, you know, playing on Quentin's level, though, you're doing something right.
He's a beast.
Yeah. You know, I did just want to back this up a little bit, though, because, you know, over the course of your time at ECU, you know, things change, you know, you play positions, you know, you deal with the injury this year, you know, a little bit of adversity, different positional coaches. I mean, when you think, even just going back to like 2016, you're a freshman, injured after one game, do you recall just sort of how you've dealt with getting dealt these, you know, bad situations and having to, you know, sort of regroup and figure out how to get back and up your game? I mean, what did going through those different, you know, spats of adversity teach you?
You know, it just taught me a lot about mental health and understanding what you need to do to make sure that you're feeling okay to compete and do well for yourself and understanding that, you know what I mean, things are a part of life. And, you know what I mean, just understanding that it's a part of growing and just take care of yourself and just keep moving forward. You know what I mean? It's just things are going to happen, but you got to just keep pressing forward.
And you sort of mentioned your faith toward the beginning of our conversation. I see it all over your Twitter feed as well. So I'm sure that's a big piece of it too.
Yes, sir. Just like God, I feel like it's somebody like, I don't feel like I have the same relationship as everyone else does. You know what I mean? Everyone has their each own relationship with God. And I just feel like as like someone I could talk to, someone I know works for me, you know what I mean? Like literally works to help heal my heart or whatever, you know what I mean? I'm going through in my mind or whatever. So, you know what I mean? That's a big peace comfort for me.
Of course. You know, I just wanted to ask one other question. You know, the wrestling background, man, I to me, that's fascinating that you're a multi-sport athlete. You know, even if football was your primary sport, how much did having that wrestling understanding help you just continue to develop as a football athlete?
The wrestling really took my football to another game, to another level, because I understood football. I always understood football, but I always couldn't do my body to do like certain things or something like that. So wrestling really allowed me to unlock my body and just learn how to do different things that you may not have been comfortable with and learn to grow through it and feel through that type of stuff. So feeling through things, you know what I mean? I'm not afraid of a new way to do something, you know what I mean? Because the wrestling kind of like took all of that out of me. A lot of that stuff was new for me. And it taught me a lot about balance and my hands and feet working together. So it's just a lot about like coordination and just like body movement. It helped me out a lot.
Yeah. I've heard wrestlers say similar things. Wrestlers that became football players anyway. It's just that overall body control and understanding balance. Mm-hmm. But you know, from what I heard you say, you're doing another thing to help balance and flexibility, and that's yoga. So how is yoga, in all seriousness, how is doing more of that type of, exercise helped you sort of improve your overall just physical health, even mental health?
Most definitely. I do yoga twice a week. Yoga is helping me get my ankles more flexible. You know what I mean? I just want to be more flexible, you know what I mean? And just have, it easier for me to like do the things I want to do. You know what I mean? Just be able to take care of my body a little better. So that's part of what I want to do. And the yoga is also like relaxing to me. You know what I mean? That's a way that I also can like be with God and like clear my mind, but it's also a way like I can also free my mind of like any mental stressors or anything like that to certain ways. So I can have like my mental health time also. So I like yoga a lot for my body and for my mind.
Between COVID and then the injury and then just the stress of trying to get ready for the draft, what else are you doing to just sort of keep a level mind? We have yoga, we have your faith. I mean, what does D’Ante do when there's a little bit of downtime to just relax?
I talk to my family, my mom and my girlfriend a lot. I have friends stationed in different parts of America. A couple of my friends are in the military or whatever. So we get online, play games. Some of my friends still in college playing games or like my friends back home. So that's how I really just kill time every now and then.
So what's the game of choice?
Madden. Sometimes 2K, but Madden.
Okay, I thought it was going to be Call of Duty or Madden, but 2K should definitely be in the rotation. Well, man, I just, one other thing about Twitter that I had to mention was you have a pinned tweet. Pride makes us artificial, humility makes us real, from Thomas Merton. So, man, I just wanted to ask you about that. What does that mean to you?
For myself, like things I had to learn, you know what I mean? Just things like I may be looking at a situation from a sense of pride or a sense of entitlement or something like that, but you know what I mean? But that's not the situation. That's not how I should be looking at that situation. I'm not privileged. I shouldn't be looking at a situation like that anyway. I should just be being optimistic and trying to make the best out of a situation. So just trying not to let your pride get in the way of who you are and what you're trying to be, you know what I mean?
For sure. Now, when you, just to get a little more philosophical, if you could, when you look at what you've been able to accomplish just going from high school to get to this stage in your life, man, what would you say has been the hardest part? And what's the best part so far in your journey?
The hardest part was like I said, just learning. You know, for me, I'm not really like a, I'm not a big, big social person. Like I love being around people and stuff like that, but I'm not like the type of person that be around a whole bunch of parties and stuff like that. So for me, it's just mainly like just when I moved away from home all the way to East Carolina, about 5.5 hours away, it was just me learning how to make myself happy and make myself, you know what I mean, feel good, you know what I mean? So that was a big part about everything. That was the hardest thing for me to do, just to really get in tune with myself. But I made that adjustment, and that's been like the best thing for me.
Yeah, that self-sufficient aspect of it, being good on your own. But, you know, so what would you say then was the best?
The best thing is just the amount of knowledge I learned, the amount of stuff I know now just about life in general, maybe business or even football. Just learning so much more, it's limitless to what you can do with that information.
Speaking of being limitless with what you can do with information, man, I saw that you did get your degree in applied economics. So, you know, obviously it seems like it's all football first. There's going to be a big career ahead of you, but why economics? Do you have any sort of plans or aspirations outside of football?
Most definitely. I plan on one day becoming a financial advisor or something of that sort. You know what I mean? So I always wanted to get my degree in economics or finance, and I have my minor in business administration so I can help, you know what I mean, pursue my dreams in that after I finish football.
Well, you definitely sound like you're not going to be a statistic. You're going to be the guy that manages his money well. You're going to be able to set yourself up for all sorts of success no matter what you get into after football.
Thank you so much.
Well, man, I want to end this little thing on what I call the gauntlet. It is just a couple quick hitter questions, man. I need to know your knee-jerk reaction on a few things, starting with what's most important. Is it having the number one offense or the number one defense?
Defense.
All right. Now, did you have a pregame ritual that you'd stick to?
No.
All right. Favorite football memory to date?
My friend Jared Cox, we're playing Evans High School, 2015. He catches like a little pass on the sideline. He runs. He jumps over dude. They hit him in the leg. He lands the flip and keeps running, like tiptoes out of bounds. Mid-game, he landed on his feet.
That's awesome. Yeah, that's hell crazy. Of a memory.
Jared Cox.
Was it on film?
It's probably on film somewhere. I know we went crazy. I remember just seeing like the film vantage point from a fan's perspective one time. It was just like the field view level. So it's just like me and some other teammates running over. And like you could see him flip a little bit, but you see like the stands and everybody go crazy the whole time. So that's like a crazy.
Yeah, for sure. So what's most important? Is it the players or is it the scheme?
The players.
All right. So, man, one last one for you. What is the best piece of advice that you would give to a young student athlete that looks at you and says, man, how do I get to where he is?
You got to work and you got to pray. You know what I mean? Things don't happen overnight. It's going to take a long time, long process for you to get to where you want to be, but you just got to keep working and keep praying.
Well, there you have it. From someone that's gone from a three-star recruit, battled through some injuries, you know, doesn't get to play his senior year, but boom, here he is. Certainly, in my opinion, you know, a top 100 pick in the draft. Like I said, future Hall of Famer D’Ante Smith. D’Ante, man, thank you so much for taking the time. I cannot wait to see what the road has for you.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much for having me.
Boom.